Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. My name is Rahim Haji, and I'm honored and privileged to have been given this opportunity to be your master of ceremonies for this evening's program. On the same token, however, it is very sad that the result of human pain and suffering is what has brought us here together this evening. The situation in Kosovo is one that is not new in modern history. In this past decade alone, we have witnessed the genocide of Tutsis in Rwanda. We have seen the ethnic cleansing of Bosnian Muslim peoples in the Balkans. And now we are witnesses to the extermination of Kosovo Albanians in Kosovo. Ladies and gentlemen, the cause of these atrocities is an undeniable lack of respect for human dignity. Tonight's program has been designed with primary two objectives. Primarily, to raise funds to provide much-needed medical supplies to the Kosovo refugees and to increase awareness of the situation facing them. As part of these objectives, the Honorable Joseph Dioguardi and other speakers will address us this evening. At this time, I would also like to welcome the 14 Kosovars who arrived in Canada last night. It is with a deep sense of sadness that they should be forced to leave their own countries and homes for sanctuary in Canada. To our new friends from Kosovo, Mirse Keni Arda na Canada. We will commence tonight's program with the bilingual recitation of our national anthem by a young Canadian, Frizana Jaffer Jeraj. I would like to request that you all please rise for our national anthem.
Oh, Canada, our home and native land, true patriot love in all thy sons command, count on brasse porte le pays, il sait porte la croix. Ton histoire est une épopée des plus brillants exploits. God keep our land glorious and free. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Stand on guard for thee.
I would now like to ask Ms. Alia Dili and Dr. Shelly Kasim to render tonight's prayer.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In a world where darkness surrounds us, a ray of light shimmering through touches and lifts all our spirits. Let us today be the beacon of light for those embedded in such darkness. For the displaced people of Kosovo, let us give hope, prayer, love, and compassion to soothe and heal them through their heart-wrenching pain. I would like to call upon each and every one of you to please stand together for a ceremonial lighting for this flame of hope. Please rise. At your table, you will find a match and a little lamp. If somebody could please start lighting this. Let us reach into the deep recesses of ourselves and bring out this ray of hope and love. Sirat al-Nur. God is the light of the heavens and the earth. The parable of this light is as if there were a niche and within it a lamp, the lamp enclosed in glass. The glass, as it were, a brilliant star lit from a blessed tree. an olive, neither of the east nor of the west, whose oil is well nigh luminous, though fire scarce touched it. Light upon light, God doth guide whom he will. To his light, God doth set forth parables for men, and God doth know all things. Amen.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace be upon all of us and the mercies and blessings of God. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawm al-Din. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. Sirat al-ladina anamt alayhim. Ghayr al-maghdubi alayhim wa al-dallin. Ameen. In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful. Praise be to God, Lord of the universe, the compassionate, the merciful, sovereign of the day of judgment. You alone we worship, and to you alone we turn for help. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those whom you have favored, not of those who have incurred your wrath, nor of those who have gone astray. Before the meal is served, we pray to God Almighty to bless our fellowship and to bless the food we will be sharing. Amen.
Commence with the remainder of tonight's program. But before we do so, I'd like to offer shukran to Allah for providing us with tonight's meal. I would also like to provide gratitude to the many sponsors that you have on the inside of your program. In addition to those listed there, we have received two additional sponsorships this evening. Hiro Isovic of EBCO Industries and Mr. and Mrs. Abdul Khatun Danani. I would now like to call upon Ms. Maryam Abbasi to offer an official welcome on behalf of the Canadian Council of Muslim Communities. Maryam is the coordinator of the Committee for Racial Justice and is actively involved with the Council of Muslim Communities and the Pacific Interfaith Citizenship Association of BC.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. On behalf of the Council of Muslim Communities of Canada, in short CMCC, I extend to you all a very warm welcome to this fundraising dinner. CMCC is a national organization of Canadian Muslims. It came into being in the year 1971. Our activities extend well beyond our members in Canada, which is now estimated to be 750,000. We have had a fair share of ups and downs, but we continue to do our work and reach out not only to Muslims throughout Canada, but also to other fellow Canadians, our supporters, and our friends. We have been actively involved in the interfaith dialogue and interfaith activities. The coming together this evening of people of different faiths and backgrounds to help those in need, those who need our help most, and is witness to our human capacity to work for a noble cause and to bring an end to hardship, pain, and suffering of our fellow human beings. Recently, we worked with the McGill University Department of Islamic Studies in Montreal to co-host a two-day seminar on Islam and the new millennium. We have been actively involved in Ontario in providing services to the seniors in Toronto and Ottawa. Here in British Columbia, we supported the initiative taken by the provincial government to successfully conclude the NISCA Treaty. The list goes on. In Islam, charity and helping the poor and the needy has been given a very high status next to our everyday prayers. We believe this is also true for all world religions. Your support and your presence here this evening speaks for itself. In conclusion, we'd like to thank our Canadian government, our Prime Minister, Honorable Jean Chrétien, our Foreign Minister, Honorable Lloyd Axworthy, and our Minister of Immigration and Citizenship, Honorable Lucien Robillard, for their compassion and their understanding of the situation in Kosovo. We have also received a message from Honorable Herb Dhaliwal, Minister of National Revenue, which I would request Aziz Kaki, Vice President of the CMCC, to read. Thank you once again very much for your presence and your overwhelming support.
Thank you, madam. Before she came here, she thought there was an earthquake, and I had to assure her that there was nothing wrong, and she did it an excellent job. Thank you once again. As Maria mentioned, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As Maria mentioned, that we have received a letter from Herb Dhaliwal, whom we had invited to come and to join us in this event. However, he was unable to come. One of the reasons was that last Sunday he was in Vancouver at a funeral of his auntie, and that's why he could not take the second trip to Vancouver. This is how his letter goes. Dear Aziz, it is with regret that I am unable to join you tonight as you meet to discuss the current situation in Kosovo and what the future may hold for Kosovo Albanians. I will, however, be with you in spirit as you help to increase awareness of the very difficult plight of the refugees. The human suffering experienced by the thousands of people who have been so brutally expelled from their homes in Kosovo is very disturbing. We are witnesses to their despair each and every day. Canada, with a long history of international cooperation and brotherhood, has quickly responded to an urgent request from the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, Canada has welcomed the first waves of the 5,000 Kosovar refugees who will be staying with us on an emergency basis throughout the country. As Canadians, we can be proud that offering assistance to this victim will help to advance the goals of peace and stability for the refugees themselves as well as for the entire region. Assisting refugees in Canada also requires the hard work and collaboration of non-government organizations both in Canada and abroad. Doctors Without Borders has been an invaluable resource for so many displaced persons around the globe, and their selfless determination in helping to make difference in the Balkans. The contribution and support that all of you have given tonight helps immeasurably. Thank you once again, sincerely, Herb Dhaliwal, Minister of National Revenue. Thanks.
It should be noted that the funds that are raised at tonight's program will be directed towards Doctors Without Borders, who will be using the funds for medical supplies in the region. We would now like to proceed on to the next part of our program. I would like to call upon Dr. Mel Dilley to introduce our guest speaker for the evening. Dr. Dilley represents the Albanian and Bosnian communities of British Columbia. For some time now, Dr. Dilley has been actively involved in creating awareness of the issues that have plagued our brothers and sisters in the Balkan region. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Dilley.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Before I introduce our honored guest speakers, it's fitting for the occasion, very much the purpose of why we are here in the first place, that I introduce our new refugees that have arrived last night, to our surprise, 14 of them. Mirce Keniard. Mirce Keniard, Vlazen, the Motre, in Canada. Welcome, brothers and sisters, to Canada. I have pleasure this evening, very much of a great pleasure, also of introducing to you the Honorable Joseph Dioguardi, the former United States Congressman and President of the American Albanian Civic League, together with his wife and Balkan Affairs advisor, Shirley Cloyes. Mr. Dioguardi graduated with honors from Fordham University. He served for 22 years in international accounting, being one of the first public advocates of governmental fiscal responsibility, something that us Canadians still can learn a great deal. In 1984, he brought extensive professional and volunteer experience to the United States Congress as the first practicing publicly certified accountant elected to the House. He distinguished himself by finding bipartisan solutions to extremely difficult problems. Mr. Dioguardi has also excelled as an advocate for human rights and self-determination, the reason why he is here this evening. Since 1989, he has made 16 trips to the Balkans. He has also founded the American Albanian Civic League, whose sole purpose is to further the human rights of genocided Albanians. To that end, he has recruited the help of humanitarians throughout the world, inclusive of numerous congressmen and senators, regardless of their religious or non-religious persuasion or racial or ethnic background. He has been in the forefront of raising the awareness of the plight of millions of innocent Albanians. His contribution in this regard is on par with Nobel Prize recipients. He has been warning the whole world, of another impending Holocaust in the heart of Europe, a catastrophe, as experts put it, of biblical proportions, unprecedented in Europe since the Second World War, perpetrated by evil. For all his contributions, together with his better half, Shirley Cloyes, and many other dedicated individuals, not only Albanians, but the whole humanity owes them an unpayable debt. May God bless Joe and Shirley, and may God bless all good human beings, regardless of their ethnicity, race, or religion. Ladies and gentlemen, the Honorable Joseph DioGuardi and Shirley Cloyes.
Thank you, Mel. Thank you very much, Mel. Good evening, everybody. Is everybody happy? Because I want to see smiles. You know, before you give a serious speech, you want to be sure that people are ready for it. But I see so many friendly faces here. Shirley, why don't you stand up? When we mentioned your name, nobody saw you. This is my wife, Shirley Cloyes. We are so delighted to be here, our first time in Western Canada, in Vancouver. It is a marvelous place. We flew in last night. We were so lucky to be on the plane with the people that you were just introduced to, the Shala family, because we were coming here for this very purpose, not knowing that one of the first groups of refugees would be coming along with us, and maybe the first anywhere, because I understand only in yesterday were there refugees landing in the metropolitan area, New York area, in New Jersey. But it was a wonderful experience, and for me especially, because when they were on the plane, their guide, their interpreter had to leave them, and as they were walking down the aisle, they recognized me. You know, it's a great thing to be recognized. It's a human experience, right, that everybody wants to be recognized. But here are people who recognize me because they remember when I came and brought Congressman Tom Lantos, a Democrat who fled the Holocaust himself in World War II. I brought him to Pristina in June of 1990. And we were there outside the Grand Hotel. And in front of our eyes, we saw these vicious Serbian police use truncheons, beating up the crowds and using tear gas. And they remembered the speeches we gave. And from that day to now, I see them walking down the aisle. Our eyes meet, and we greeted each other. And to see them here tonight is a wonderful experience. But that's why we're here. And they represent individually and specifically the general problem that we face today in the Balkans, and that's the displacement of so many people. And I'd like to say that we don't even know the dimension of what's in Kosovo right now, because there are at least 800,000 people that are in the borders of Kosovo. There are no monitors, no NATO troops, nobody watching, and those people may be starving as we're here, as we're sitting here. We could be repeating the scenes from World War II when the troops finally went in to the concentration camps and saw the skin and bones and the people that were dead. We don't know what to expect when finally we show the resolve to go in and complete the mission that was started by NATO. But let me tell you, I am impressed with Vancouver. Shirley and I have only been here a day or so, and to see so many wonderful people of all persuasions, multi-ethnic, multi-religious, multi-cultural, this is the kind of place that Slobodan Milosevic would love to hate. We know that. We know that by what kind of philosophy he represents, the philosophy of chauvinism, the philosophy of Stalinist communism, total control, the philosophy of ethnic cleansing, racial purity, all the things that we saw in World War II, that's what we have seen played out in the Balkans today. And it's a shame that after our Jewish brothers and sisters have said, never again, never again, never again, and I repeated that so many times myself with them when I adopted the issue of Soviet Jewry back in 1985, that we would see again concentration camps in Bosnia, rape camps in Kosovo, young men who are forced to donate blood to the Serbian army, barbaric things that you can hardly describe. And here they are in the 20th century as we go into the 21st century. And as President Clinton has said, that's why one of the reasons we're there. Before I get into that in detail, Mel mentioned, I see so many serious faces, I have to put a smile on these faces once again before I go forward. Mel mentioned that I brought the experience of a certified public accountant to Congress. I spent 22 years in what was then the world's largest accounting firm, Arthur Andersen and Company. There's been some changes since. I don't know whether it still has that distinction. But can you imagine going to Congress and finding out you're the only accountant ever elected in 215 years? Now, when I left 4 years later, guess who I left behind? 276 lawyers. Imagine a place with 276 lawyers and no accountant. That's the U.S. House of U.S. Congress, when you look at 435 in the House and 100 in the Senate. And then I heard someone say, well, what is an accountant? And one definition is an accountant is an actuary with a personality. But then I thought about, here I am so lucky to be this unusual combination of an accountant and a politician. And I said, well, what is a politician? I think a politician may be defined as a personality without an accounting background, because they all know how to spend, but no one knows how to count. That's why we have all these deficits, right? You know, I think about the question, why are we involved in Kosovo? And when I think about it from an American perspective, I certainly can't be too far off the mark from how you feel here, because I think we all share the same cultural, philosophical, spiritual feelings when it comes to helping people. And I think of what some of the great spokesmen have said. One, Dr. Martin Luther King. He said, if there is injustice anywhere, justice is threatened everywhere. And I think if you remember how Dr. Martin Luther King took the issue of racism, we're not talking about 150 years ago, the Civil War. We're talking about in America 35 to 40 years ago, when Afro-Americans were still sitting in the back of a bus. I mean, this is the pain that we suffered in America that someone with the courage and leadership of Dr. Martin Luther King had to break through. And how did he do it? He did it by being active, by being involved. Civil disobedience was, I think, his mantra. And he got people to understand that there was injustice. And I think that's one of the reasons we're here today. You took the time off to be here to do something, to get involved. And each one of us has a responsibility to get involved. Another great statesman, an Englishman, Edmund Burke, said it another way. He said, all that is necessary for evil to prevail is that good people do nothing. When good people do nothing, you can be sure there are enough bad people in the world that they will fill that vacuum very quickly, and you will see the kind of upheaval we had there. Then I think of my mother. She's 85, and she gave me a quote. And a quote that I was raised with, the 10 most powerful words in the English language. They're only two letters each. When strung together, they go, if it is to be, it is up to me. That we all have responsibility as individuals to do things. We can't wait to see what our neighbors do. We can't wait as a country to see what other countries do. If we recognize injustice, if we recognize that something is wrong, we must take individual responsibility and get involved. and get others involved. We must be like the droplets that start at the mountains and become rivulets and creeks and rivers and roaring streams and then the ocean. That's the way life is. If we wait for someone else, I don't think that's what God wanted us to do, right? And I think it's important that we all accept that responsibility. So we're in this issue in the Balkans, I think, for moral reasons. I never felt that we built a wall around America when it comes to human rights. I always felt that when my immigrant parents came there, and they came there from Italy in 1929, my father being, by the way, an ethnic Albanian whose people fled the Ottomans 500 years before, and he retained the Albanian language all those years, brought it to America, and luckily, Albanians overheard my father speaking Albanian to his younger sister at my first birthday party as a congressman in 1985 in my district. And the next day in my house, 20 Albanians from Kosovo came, showed up to tell me about a place I never heard of called Kosovo. And when I went to Congress, I found that almost nobody in Congress knew where Kosovo was, except people like Tom Lantos, a Hungarian American who was born near there, and several others. And you can imagine today how difficult it is for Americans to relate to a place called Kosovo. Many people didn't know where it is until Clinton put it on CNN and showed you the map, and there it was, only 160 miles from Italy. And there was the western shore of Albania, only 60 miles from the eastern shores of Italy. That's where, how my father's people got on the rafts when the Ottomans overran Albania. They sought asylum in the Kingdom of Naples. And now I'm here, luckily, having met some Albanian people in Congress, so they too now have at least one more strong voice for the injustices affecting them. And certainly you'll hear Shirley as another one of those strong voices. So we have to understand that this is a moral issue. We understand that foreign policies of Canada and the United States require certain protocols. Is it in our vital interests? Do we have a reason to be there? We can understand and tolerate that. I believe that this is in our vital interests. Anything that's so close to the heart of Europe with this kind of barbarity has to be in the vital interests of the United States and Canada. But even if it weren't that, when you see barbarity on the scale that we're witnessing today, when you see the state apparatus being used against an innocent population of civilians, when you see genocide on the scale that we're seeing now, genocide that has been planned, this is no accident. I have a memo. I found this memo in 1986. It was given to me by Albanians. It's dated 1937. You know what it says? The expulsion of the Albanians. It was presented by a Serb academician, Vazo Trubilovic, in Belgrade, 1937. He later became a minister in the Communist Party of Yugoslavia in World War II. This is the man that Milosevic honored just before he died. This is the memo Milosevic is reading from to clean out Kosovo. This is no accident. This has been planned for decades to purge the Albanian people from Kosovo, because this is a man who believes in greater Serbia, but he wants to blame the Albanians for greater Albania when they don't have any power to create a greater Albania. He has one of the biggest armies in Europe. We gave it to him. He played the broker with his predecessors for 50 years as the broker between the Warsaw Pact nations and the United States and the West. And we gave him all those weapons that he's now using against the innocent Albanian people. And don't forget the 250,000 innocent Bosnian civilians that were brutally killed because we didn't act soon enough. We waited 2 years and lost 250,000 people. How many innocent Albanians have to die before we finally act and commit the ground troops and go in there and finish what we started? This is not a political issue. We're already there. The bombs are dropping. We're showing the resolve we should have shown years ago. That's the only language Mr. Milosevic understands. But until we go in there and finish the job and make sure he is out of the picture, because he doesn't deserve, he hasn't got any longer the moral authority to lead either the Albanian or the Serbian people by what he's done. He should be indicted as a war criminal. The United States Congress has said it. Why are we so reluctant to put his name at the top of that list of 9 generals that we've publicized? Because we think we may have to deal with him to come up with a political settlement? What kind of political settlement can you have with someone who's been trying to purge you from your own land, land that you've had a connection to for 10,000 years? The Albanians are the only indigenous people of the Balkans. They are the Illyrians. Not even the Greeks were there when the Albanians were there. They came in 2500 BC. Now, why are we saying that this is... But we're not saying that we want to win this based on history, because if you want to win it just based on history, we'd have to give a lot of land back to the Indians in the United States. So it's not just an historic issue. But when people say it's not Albanian land, I have to stand up and remind them that the Albanians were there first. And you know where the Serbs came from? They came from the Ukraine. People want to know, why is Russia always so interested in the Serbs? These are their blood brothers and sisters, or at least blood first cousins, because they came from the Ukraine in the 6th century AD. Again, no problem. Serbian people are good people. The German people are good people. They've been poisoned by the last vestiges of Stalinist communism in Europe. That's what Slobodan Milosevic represents. He represents ethnically cleansed mini-states, racial purity. Look what he did to Sarajevo, that beautiful city that we witnessed in the Olympics on our TV screens, where everybody lives side by side, Jews, Muslims, Bosnians, Albanians, you name it. That was the first target, because he wanted to send a signal that this was not what he wanted. He wanted to control everything. And you know what Stalinist communism is? It's the worst form of it. It's total control of everything. The media, the schools, the army. That's what you're seeing. You disagree, you're fired, or you're killed. And the Albanians have had to suffer this for so many years. It just didn't start now for Albanians. The world is just finding out what the Albanian people had to suffer. They've been excluded from the world scene because for 50 years after World War II, they were oppressed, suppressed, held in concentration camps that were countries, one in Albania. Worst dictator in the world, an Albanian, Enver Hoxha, put the Albanian people in a literal concentration camp called Albania. They couldn't get out, you couldn't get in for 50 years. And then they collaborated with the communists in Belgrade. So all the Kosovars, ethnic Albanians, could not really do anything. So for 50 years, while Serb academicians, good people, were running around rewriting history because they were given these formulations by their Stalinist governments and people like Trbilovic, Albanian people couldn't respond. And that's why there's such victimization today and such confusion in the press. Who are these Albanians? Why should we be there? A great nation of people has suffered so much just in the last 50 years and in the last 10 years. Think about the last 10 years alone. Let me just take you on a trip to recent history, because this started in Kosovo in 1989. Do you remember that Kosovo was an equal, had an equal vote to Serbia? Maybe you don't, because I know in America, we don't read Eastern European history. We don't understand Yugoslavia. Very complicated to understand a country that had 6 republics and 2 autonomous provinces, 8 areas, Croatia, Slovenia, Macedonia, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Serbia, then Kosovo, then Vojvodina, and Montenegro. 8. They all had an equal vote in the old, former Yugoslavia's confederal republic. Now you look at Milosevic, he says Kosovo is a suburb of Belgrade. It had its own parliament, its own hospital system, its own judiciary, its own police force. And that was all taken away in 1989 with tanks, with guns. I went there. I brought Congressman Tom Lantos and Senator Bob Dole with 600 senators to see it. They couldn't believe it. Albanians have been living under the most brutal occupation since World War II, and it's been going on, and you didn't know it, for the last 10 years. And then what did Mr. Milosevic do when we didn't act? The first blunder of the United States of America when he did that? We didn't do anything. We kind of appeased him. He decided, I have to go get those Slovenes now. They're acting a little bit too independent. And thank God they had the terrain on their side, and they had some weapons before the embargo, and they beat him back. He quickly took his losses and went into Croatia. And you saw what he did in Croatia. bombs the jewel city of Europe, one of them, Dubrovnik. Not even Hitler would do that. In fact, two cities were off limits for Hitler. They were the Vatican and Dubrovnik. That didn't stop Mr. Milosevic from bombing Dubrovnik. This is how brutal this individual was and the people that he killed. Then we saw him go into Bosnia, and we acted 2 years too late, and now he's back to Kosovo. Why are we appeasing someone like Milosevic? Why did we tell him in 1991, this is Secretary of State Baker, I blame both Bush and Clinton, although I praise Clinton for showing the resolve, think about the blunder that was made by President Bush when his Secretary of State announces that we will keep Yugoslavia together at all costs. We then made our partnership with Milosevic. That's exactly what he wanted to hear, because he says, now I'll do the dirty work for the United States of America. I'm going to make sure that none of these republics who have declared their independence leaves. So he started his march forward. And then our lobby, the Albanian lobby, goes in and gets an amendment to the Foreign Aid Appropriations Bill that there'll be no aid to Yugoslavia in 1991 and 1992. And our State Department puts a writer in, 1 o'clock in the morning, that the Secretary of State has 6 months to certify whether or not Serbia was complying with international standards of human rights. And if they certified, then the aid would go through. What does Mr. Baker do? Certifies. In light of the fact that every year our State Department country reports showed that Serbia and Yugoslavia, but Serbia in particular, had the worst record of human rights of anybody in Europe since World War II. They just turned the other way, signed the certification so that they could keep Mr. Milosevic in business. And then we get to Mr. Holbrooke in 1995. Dayton makes a deal with the devil. The devil himself, Milosevic, tells Mr. Holbrooke, okay, I killed 250,000 people. You want your peace. I know you're going to write your book. I'll let you have the peace. All right, we'll do it at Dayton, but don't bring the Albanians to the table. And I don't want to discuss Kosovo. And we agree. Blunder number three. We disenfranchised the third largest ethnic group in the Balkans, the Albanian people. 7 million people living side by side, contiguously. Did you ever think about that? Why are Albanians in five different jurisdictions? Albania, Southeast Montenegro, Western Macedonia, Kosovo, and Southern Serbia. That has to be a question that comes to your mind. Milosevic uses it against the Albanians all the time. He says, oh, look at these Albanians. They came in and they took our Serbian property, and now we have to get rid of them. Albanians were there. They never moved. It was Russia again at the end of World War I, or just before it ended, that made the deal for their South Slavic brothers. They created this state called Yugoslavia. Yugo means South, South Slavia. And they literally took a line, went right down the middle of the state of Albania that had emerged in 1912 from the Ottoman occupation after 450 years, and said, now, this half of the Albanian state's in Yugoslavia. Why? Did they want the Albanian people? No. You know what they wanted? They wanted the Trepska mines in Kosovo. The largest gold mines in Europe are right there in northern Kosovo. That's what Mr. Milosevic is after. And they wanted the breadbasket of the Balkans. The most fertile land is in Kosovo. You don't hear that. What you hear is, oh, stay away. This is a religious war. It's civil. It's ethnic. It's historic. Your sons will go home in body bags. Don't get involved. Baloney. It's political, because he wants to maintain total control as a communist leader there. And two, it's money. Even the Serbian director of the Trepska mines was quoted in the London Times last year that the war in Kosovo is about the mines and nothing else. This is Serbia's Kuwait. That's exactly what Novich Belic said in the quote. And yet you haven't heard one word about these mines yet. And you're going to hear them pretty soon, because now they're talking about partition. And you can be sure the partition is going to include the gold mines and the chrome mines and the coal mines that are in northern Kosovo. And Albanians will not accept it. So there's a lot more to this than you can believe. But there's the third blunder, that Holbrooke would have the nerve to say we're going to have a peace accord for the Balkans, long-term peace, and keep the Albanian people off the table, because Mr. Milosevic said, that's what I want. And now we come to last year, and we find out in 1998, after Drenica, you remember the massacres in Prikaz, 45 members of the Jashari family, eyes gouged out, babies, women, children, tortured, brutalized. If you saw the pictures, you wouldn't believe it. I brought them to Congress to show them. And then the KLA emerges, Kosovo Liberation Army, that great word, liberation. Why? Nobody was helping the Albanian people. They had to defend themselves. And that's how this emerged. And what does Mr. Holbrooke do last May? Meet secretly with, in the Leeds Castle in London. I only found this out when I went to London with Shirley in January, and one of the aides of one of the members of Parliament told me this, and we're going to confirm it. But they had a meeting with Mr. Vedrine and several others, and Holbrooke, that we have to let now Mr. Milosevic get rid of the KLA. They're in the way. We need to make a quick settlement here. So the green light is given last May to wipe out the KLA. And what does Mr. Milosevic do? Torches 500 villages, and Lord knows how many mass graves we have in Kosovo now. Not one monitor has yet been able to go to that area in Kosovo. Now we've counted 43 mass graves from the satellites in that area. We just still don't know how many people have been killed. Again, the green light was given. And then the next blunder, last October. Oh, we have now a ceasefire. Mr. Milosevic again is going to give us a ceasefire. Has he kept one agreement? Not one. But yet now Holbrooke has the nerve to announce we have a ceasefire, and Mr. Milosevic will keep to a certain level. Now, there shouldn't be one Serbian troop there, according to Mr. Bush, who said back in 1991 as he was leaving, he drew the line in the sand. God forbid, Mr. Milosevic, you bring one VJ troop, one Yugoslav troop here, we will act. We've seen enough. And Clinton confirmed that. And that's still our policy. There are 40,000 there right now. When we were talking at Rambouillet, there were at least 15,000. And while we were talking at Rambouillet, to make the peace deal, Milosevic had those other troops marching down already with the M84 tanks. And this is a man that we now want to make a peace deal with? I saw CNN this morning, I couldn't believe my eyes. Gerhard Schroeder and Clinton saying that now we may have the elements of a peace involving Russia, who's never been fair about this, always takes the side of the Serbs. That's what they want to do, fine, but we have to know better. And now he's saying that we may have to have a peace that Milosevic will have to accept. Who wants to deal with Mr. Milosevic? Why should he be included in any formulation for peace when the long-term peace and stability of the Balkans is at stake? And that's what's at stake right now. We have to show the resolve to do the right thing, and that's to, one, eliminate Mr. Milosevic as a player. He must be brought to The Hague, indicted, and dealt with that way. Number two, deal with the real issues in Kosovo. And they're not partition or autonomy. Albanians have lived under autonomy. They had full autonomy since 1974, and they were brutalized, and nobody knew about it. They're not going to go back to that. It has to be independence for the Albanian people. They'll accept no less. And then let me conclude by just putting another face on the Albanian people for you. I've brought a number of copies of this book to leave with you because God was good to me in 1990 when I took Congressman Lantos to meet the communist leader then in Albania. He was not voted out until 1992, and he was so intimidated by the presence of a congressman who was the chairman of the Human Rights Commission, he was trying to patronize him, to buy him, so to speak, and he took out this file that no one had ever seen from the communist archives, and it was this thick. Turned out to be the heroic deeds of Albanians, Muslim Albanians, who saved every Jew in World War II that made it to Albania or into Kosovo. Don't forget, in those periods, they were connected. And by 1993, because I sent that file to Yad Vashem in Israel and the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, by 1993, a Jewish philanthropist, Havi Sana, had written the book Rescue in Albania, which shows that not one of the 2,000 Jews in Albania, and some were there from Roman times, a shipwreck of Romaniyats. Remember when the Romans brought the Judean maidens to Rome? Well, some of those ships never made it. And there was a colony of them in Albania for 2,000 years. Also, Jews that were expelled from Spain during the Spanish Inquisition. Not all of them went to Turkey. Some of them came to Albania. So 2,000 Jews were already in Albania practicing their faith. And another 2,000 were lucky enough to make it across the border because they heard that if you made it to Albania or in Albanian lands, the Albanian people, their tradition was that if you're their guest, they would risk their life for you. And here you have accounts in this book, and I'll leave you many copies, of Muslim women putting Jewish men in their beds as the Nazis came by the door at risk for their life to save them. These are the most tolerant people you could find. And I'm not saying this because it's a religious issue. It's not. These are a people that have tolerance as their standard of life. They share three religions. Two-thirds of the Albanian people today are Muslim. One-third are Christian. Of the one-third of the Christian, two-thirds are Eastern Orthodox, one-third are Roman Catholic. They intermarry freely. Religion's not an issue with them. They've lived side by side all other people. The problem is the politics of Slobodan Milosevic and the path that he took. And we have to understand that. And we have to understand that some of the most tolerant people, one of the most ancient nations in the world, is now subject to the most brutal barbarity we've seen since World War II. And we must solve this thing the right way. No more compromises. Let's do it right, because it's in our interest as we go into the 21st century to see a Europe that President Clinton has defined as unified, prosperous, and democratic. Certainly a Balkans, that's an integral part of that Europe, that is at peace in a long-lasting way with stability. If we achieve that, then we've achieved a lot. In the meantime, what we're doing tonight, helping the refugees that are here, the ones that are there, by your presence here, we're doing God's work. God bless you for being here. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Let me introduce my wife, Shirley. We met because she was doing a book. She is a publisher. She ran a publishing house for 10 years, very complicated books on international politics. But we met 5 years ago when she was doing a book on Yugoslavia's ethnic nightmare. And she has a wonderful background. She's a graduate of Union Theological Seminary. She's a Presbyterian. I'm a Roman Catholic. She's a Democrat. I'm a Republican. And somehow we get together on tough issues like this, and we understand it the same way. And I'm delighted because Shirley has brought with her the energy, the determination, the competence, the integrity that you need when you're dealing with an issue this tough. And I love her for more reasons than that, but I love her specifically for that as well. Thank you.
I want to assure you I'm not a representative of the Democratic Party of the United States. Thank you very much. It's a great privilege to be here. I'm very excited about our entire experience in Vancouver because it relates exactly to why I became involved in this conflict as a non-Albanian, and I think it's important for people to understand a little bit about that. I don't have, as many people in this room have, any immigrant experience or experience of threat of death for my identity or expulsion. My relatives came from England to the United States in 1644. Nevertheless, my whole identity and concept of what I believe is important, and I believe what is important is that the only way to use the miracle of being born is to fight oppressive power. That knowledge came to me through my experience of the Jewish community. When I was 9 years old, I remember the Eichmann trials were going on. It was the first time I came to understand. I went to my parents with a copy of the New York Times, which published pictures of the ovens on the front page, literally in fear and trembling, demanding an explanation for what was happening. It was the first personal breakthrough I had into the path that I would eventually tread. After that, what was really important to me was the African-American experience in the United States. And then, of course, as Joe mentioned, I went to Union Theological Seminary, which is non-denominational and includes Muslims, Christians, Jews, and people from the North as well as the South, Asia, Africa, Latin America. And I went there at a time when liberation theology was very much in force and in the world. And finally, I ultimately went on to Lawrence Hill Books, which is where Joe and I met as a publisher. And I was publishing the very first book on the conflict in Bosnia because I, like many of you, I'm sure, this was now, what, in 1991, 92. Every day, oh, and I should say, by the way, I prior to this point, I was probably the major publisher of books on the Arab-Israeli conflict, representing Palestinian rights and the two-state solution. So that when I saw every day on our television screens the carnage in Bosnia and people dying and the concealing of the concentration camps, the hardest thing for me was not just the genocide that was happening. It was the message we were getting. I don't know what you heard in Canada, but I certainly know what I heard in the United States. Every day we would see these images and we were told, this is not our war. It has nothing to do with you. This is a quagmire. We can't get trapped in it. Oh, these people have been fighting for centuries. It's the product of ethnic hatred that's virtually genetic. And I was so appalled by the message that were being sent. There's nothing worse than to send a message like this to a highly privileged population and great majority in the United States to say, we are going to watch, you will watch this violence, you will be inured to it, and you will be told that you have nothing to do with this. And I decided right away that no, I was sorry, to the United States, no, this is our war. This was our war, this still is our war. And I decided to publish a book, the first in the United States, from the perspective of those who were fighting the war from the inside, from the region. Because the only information we were getting, you may have been getting other information, was basically scholarly textbooks from professors in England. We weren't hearing the story of the genocide in Bosnia from the inside. And in the former Yugoslavia, unlike in the United States, the anti-war opposition was concentrated in the media, in the independent press. So this book was comprised of journalists from Bosnian Muslims, Serbs, Croats, Macedonians. And I met Joe in October of 93. Through one of my authors, who was on her way to the Central Asian Republics and Kosovo, and he said, well, where are your Albanian authors? And I was just learning for the first time about Kosovo, and I just said, I'm sorry, this book, I'm learning about this, but this book is now very far into production. And it's deeply in trouble as a project. My parent company was furious about all of the effort and money that was being spent on this. And he said, no, really, I want you to listen to this. And I gained an incredible education over about a six-month period initially through Joe and other members of the Albanian American Civic League. Now, think about it. If I didn't know about Kosovo, and I didn't know about the Albanian national cause, and I had been publishing books for 10 years on domestic and international politics, how many other people in the West didn't know? And one of the reasons, and Joe mentioned this briefly in his speech before, for 50 years, Slavic-dominated scholarship and Slavic influence from Belgrade in the United States influenced our understanding and our lack of knowledge. And I began to call the Albanian diaspora in America, well, first of all, I began to call Albania, Albanians throughout the Balkans, the largest divided nation in Europe, but I began to call the Albanian diaspora the largest invisible minority in the United States. And this invisibility is crucial, and I want to just mention some dimensions of that here tonight, because unless we break through the invisibility, we're starting to now, and you may know this from your own cultural and religious experience, and we certainly saw this in Nazi Germany, to hark back to the other worst devastation in the heart of Europe in this century, that creating the demonization and the destruction of a culture takes patterns that are all too familiar. And the lack of knowledge about the Albanian world is now going to be a matter of life and death. So you in this room who are aiding the refugee population and are bearing your witness yourselves because of your own experience, everyone here is desperately needed now. And I want to mention some of the dimensions of what I think we all need to know and act on before I think it may be too late. I think we have to, first of all, to break the invisibility, we have to insist on using the word genocide. I don't know whether it's a debate in Canada, but throughout Europe, you notice. We don't want to use that word. Now, why is that? In the United States, I know why we don't want to use it, because then we would have to act on the Genocide Convention, which came out of the World War II experience. So you will hear US officials talking about this, you know, horrific situation, but they will not use the word, and we have to use it. We have the scenes of people being forced out in cattle cars. We have more than 600 now, 700,000 as of today expelled. We have people being tortured. We have rape camps. We have Albanian men, supposedly 100,000 Albanian men and boys have, quote, disappeared. We know they're not, you know, the American government, the US government may not know where they are. I know they're dead. We know that we had 500 Albanian villages torched to the ground this summer. The 43 mass graves that we're discovering now, you can be sure some of those occurred during the Serbian summer offensive. And above all, we have 800,000 people trapped inside now without food and water. So once the troops go in, the Western troops, where, you know, the desire now is we cannot risk a single life, we will go in only after the fact. I fear what we're going to go in and we're going to find just mounds of corpses, because we've already heard, everyone here has heard about the summary execution that's going on, the burning of bodies, and outright starvation. So we're going to have to use the word genocide. We cannot participate in the concealing of information or the misrepresentation. This is what happened in many historical periods that we're familiar with. It certainly happened to the Jews, where the deportations were going on, the information about the camps were going on, we denied it. We delayed immigration, we didn't bomb the tracks to Auschwitz. We certainly have an unpaid debt to Africa in many, many ways, but specifically in terms of the genocide in Rwanda, when the international community and the United States failed to act, they could have. You know, we have to start looking at a pattern and saying, what kind of new world order are we moving into? And we cannot accept the apparatus, the non-military apparatus that is used to destroy peoples. Sorry about these glasses, but for one thing, the Albanian experience, and I think you can see this from what's going on now, but I don't know whether you realize this is not a one-year war. You'll hear a lot of references to one-year war. This is preposterous. There's a planned disintegration of the Albanian population in the Balkans, or assimilation, both, by Slavic regimes that's gone on for 100 years. And Albania, the state itself, was created actually by Woodrow Wilson. Joe was mentioning this when the Albanian world came out of the Ottoman Empire. If it hadn't been for Wilson, there would be no nation of Albania. But Milosevic rose to power on a platform of anti-Albanian racism. And we've seen the process of Milosevic moving from country to country since 1991. So this is not something that recently happened. You also will hear almost nothing about the occupation. This has been the most brutal occupation leading up to the genocide in Europe. It's been 10 years in the making. And as Joe mentioned, this is happening on not Serbian land, but on Albanian land. Albanians are the original Illyrians, and they were there for thousands of years before the Serbs came. And it was a Serbian land grab that took Kosovo away in 1912, 1913, which is when the Balkan Wars occurred. One of the things that you will probably have noticed is that there is a great attempt now, and this is part of a pattern of misrepresentation, to criminalize the KLA and to refer to it as some type of shadowy fringe terrorist group, you know, responding to the whims of political extremists. And you'll see that type of language side by side statements like Madeleine Albright saying they're not a terrorist group, or Jamie Shea of the Pentagon saying, the KLA is cooperating with NATO, which happens to be true. But in our press, and as the genocide increases and the Serbian propaganda machine rolls out, And this is important because a lot of people were very well-meaning in the United States believe this. And it's going to matter a great deal because you cannot, at the end of the 20th century, expect people to be oppressed year after year on the basis of their race and ethnicity and not expect them to rise up. And certainly not in the face of genocide. And the Kosovo Liberation Army is a people's grassroots movement that rose up in response to the occupation. So it makes it all the more grotesque when the media and several politicians throughout the world try to create a false parody also. If they're not trying to criminalize the KLA, they're trying to create a false parody between the Kosovo Liberation Army and the Yugoslav Army. The Yugoslav Army and paramilitary forces are the largest military power in the former East Bloc next to Russia. There's no comparison. And they are engaged in state-sponsored terrorism. The other thing that I think we have to understand is this notion that, well, we have to continue to work with Mr. Milosevic. As Joe said, it's time for him to be indicted in The Hague as a war criminal. The worst legacy I think we have coming out of Dayton is precisely that. We're always told, oh, we have to, maintain the peace in Bosnia. What peace in Bosnia? They destroyed Bosnia in many, many ways and created into a type, and almost into a Bantustan, which is controlled by external forces. And now, after the Albanians were excluded from that process, we're being told that we have to go back, you know, with Mr. Milosevic. Be very careful, I think, in listening to the voices that created Dayton, and then those that created Rambouillet. I know Canada wasn't figuring prominently into this process at all, but you all know about Mr. Brodin and Mr. Cook and Mr. Hill and Mr. Holbrooke. And these are people that clearly don't understand the process and are not working on behalf of the Albanian nation. And just a couple of more things. You'll hear a lot about in the next few weeks about, we can't give independence to Kosovo because they must have autonomy or there'll be a wider war in Europe. What do we have now? It's definitely a wider war. We can't give independence because there'll be a fight for greater Serbia, greater Albania. Well, greater Albania is just not on the table. It never has been. We have a quest for greater Serbia, and every time Mr. Milosevic moves into another country, he's being rewarded. And it's time, if we're going to partition anyone, to partition Mr. Milosevic. If we don't do something now, he will not only exterminate and expel the entire Albanian population of Kosovo, but he will move next into Montenegro and continue thereafter. And lastly, and this is very important, especially because this particular meeting was convened through the great work of the Council of Muslim Communities, a very, very unfortunate aspect of this conflict, and certainly it goes back to Bosnia, at least in the United States government, there is a completely unfounded, distorted, and reprehensible fear of the rise of an Islamic State in the heart of Europe. And we all know that Albanians are moderate secular Muslims. The same is true of the Turkish population. We also know that many religious Muslims certainly do not represent, as this room can well attest to, anything like an extremist, fundamentalist, or terrorist force, precisely the opposite. And we cannot accept this anymore. There has to be an effort to criticize, expose, and change the definition of Islam that it's at work here, because this is one of the reasons Bosnia was carved up. And now the same thing is happening to Kosovo because it's 80% Muslim. And as Joe pointed out, Albanians have been Muslim, Eastern Orthodox, and Catholic, living in harmony for centuries. If anything, the multi-ethnic, multicultural, multi-religious ideal that Bill Clinton was referring to the other day, if he wants to find out about that, he can come meet the people of Bosnia, and he can come meet the Albanian world and others to learn more about that. And finally, from the Balkans to Rwanda, and certainly we look at what has happened to the Kurdish population, we need to understand and not accept that territorial integrity, statehood, is not inviolable. Once you commit genocide against your own population, you have forfeited the legitimacy of your boundaries. And Mr. Milosevic certainly has forfeited the legitimacy of his boundaries, apart from the fact that these are Albanian lands. And you need to understand that. Please don't buy into the notion that this is Serbian land, because it is not. And lastly, I just want to conclude that I think and I believe that most people in this room would agree with it. I mean, just the fact, and it's very powerful for me, that people from so many cultures, religions, ethnicities are coming together on behalf of this crisis. This is not something I've seen, even where we live in New York, a place as cosmopolitan as it is. I've never seen this. And it's very important to me personally, because it shows me the truth of what I believe, that in each generation, the fight against fascism, the fight against ultranationalism, the fight against genocide, the fight for peace, democracy, and freedom has to be won. We cannot take it for granted. And everyone in this room, by their presence, is showing that. And I believe that to be working on behalf of the Albanian experience is not simply to save Albanians, it's to save the world. Everyone here is showing that the nightmarish vision of racial purity and ethnically cleansed mini-states in the heart of Europe is not the future that we want. And the future that we want is one that is multicultural, multi-religious, multi-ethnic, and one that will lead us into the 21st century as a result, not with the nightmare of the past. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you very much, Mr. and Mrs. DioGuardi, for those very thought-provoking and open-minded comments. I would now like to call upon President Nazir Molgi of the Ismaili Council to offer some words of appreciation.
Honorable Joseph DioGuardi and Shirley Cloyes, you have this evening left your hearts with us, and for that we're all indebted to you. Your passion for the Albanian experience is infectious. You have both armed us with information which all 300 of us here will use to amplify your voices. All of us here are a frontierless brotherhood, and we will do our part. Thank you for taking us on a wonderful journey through Kosovo. On behalf of all of us here, I hope that you return to public life soon and continue to share your leadership. This was your first trip to Vancouver, but don't make it your last. We do have sunny days here. And actually, I have a book here with some pictures and reminders about our city that I hope that both of you can continue to read and remind you of your trip here. Please come back and visit us soon.
As the last part of tonight's agenda, I would like to call upon Mr. Aziz Kaki to offer a vote of thanks. Aziz is the president of the Committee for Racial Justice and president of the Pacific Interfaith and Citizenship Association of BC. In his spare time, if he has any, he is also the vice president of the Canadian Muslim Community for Canada. Aziz.
Assalamu alaikum.
Rahim has always been a student of mine for the last 9 years. You should have shown some more appreciation of my work. You know, when you are a last speaker, you have the advantage of no time limit. I can see some faces around here. However, after very thought-provoking, very touching, excellent expose by Joe and his wife, a great team, I don't want to take much time. But let me tell you one thing. In Canada, we have experimented this multiculturalism not just as an ideal, but we have transformed that ideal into reality. That reality has extended beyond multiculturalism and has promoted this continuous dialogue between various faiths. I remember those days when I received His Holiness the Pope at the Abbotsford Mass. I think I was the only non-Catholic, non-Christian to have had the honor of receiving him at the Abbotsford Mass. I had the honor to receive Dalai Lama. I had honor to receive Mother Teresa from Albania. I had the honor to receive a number of world figures, because when we say that we as human beings believe in to respect the human dignity, the human values, we mean it. And I, as a Muslim, one of the leaders of the Muslim community in Canada, when we greet people, we greet with the salutation of peace, Assalamu alaikum. And when you equate us with terrorism or terrorist, we will fight back. Because that's not what we stand for. However, it is indeed my pleasant task as Vice President of the CMCC to recognize and express our gratitude and sincere thanks for those who have worked very hard in putting this fundraising dinner together for the benefit of the peoples of Kosovo. And especially it made very interesting when Joe and his wife both were here to share this evening with us. You really, really touched our heart. And let me tell you, we will not let you down. Your message will go. But before you go, some of the publications you told us, I'll be very grateful if you will leave some copies for me, because we have our own contacts and we would like to be able to make sure that they get those copies. Let me begin by expressing my thanks to President Nazir Murji of the Ismailia Council for his support and his expression of appreciation for our keynote speaker. Nazir, I didn't want to update what you had said. You said it very well, and thank you very much. I know you have been a great help in organizing this dinner, and once again, thank you, and to your community. Thank you. The organizing committee has worked very hard for more than 2 months to put this fundraising this evening. And what I would like to do now is to acknowledge and thank each one of them. And please do join me, but hold on your applause until I introduce all of them, and then you can just go ahead. The committee was made up of Abid Koric. Now, Abid was actually one of the first persons who at my symposium that I had organized to honor the 50th anniversary of the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which fell on December 10, 1998, he sat near, where is Aziz Haji, Rahim's father, and he said to Aziz Haji, how about coming together and hold a fundraising dinner? And what you see today is the result of that very informal but very meaningful conversation. Thank you, Abid, for your initiative. And Mirza, yes, of course, you can never do anything without your wife. Leila Meldili was a great help. Leila. Aziz Haji, where are you, Aziz? Zul Merali, he's not here. He's, I think, in Saudi Arabia. I hope they don't keep him there. Who was very well supported by Mansoor Tejpa. Where is Mansoor Tejpa? And finally, Maryam Abbasi, who runs my office. She does the whole hard work, and I take the credit for it. It's typical of me. Ask my wife, she'll confirm that. My very special thanks to Al-Noor Samji, who worked very hard, and we are very grateful to him for his dedication, energy, and his professional skills in efficiently coordinating this event. There was not a day that Al-Noor did not phone me to say, what is about this? This is not being done. You have to do this. And I tell you, had he not been there, I think we would have had time to bring this all together. Al-Noor, thank you very much indeed. Thanks to Maryam Abbasi once again, who also helped in the coordination and in the organization of this event. Thanks to Aliya Dili for reciting of the opening chapter of the Quran and also offering the grace before the dinner. Thank you, Aliya. She also attended a number of our committee meetings. Thanks to Dr. Shelley Kassam for bringing light to the event by the recital of the Ayat al-Nur in English. Thank you very much. To Rahim Haji, who actually worked for the past 9 years during summer time in my office. Gave me a lot of headache, but I'm prepared to let it go. My office of the Committee for Racial Justice, the Pacific Interfaith Citizenship Association, and the Council of the Muslim Community of Canada. Thank you, Rahim, tonight for doing an excellent job as a master of ceremony and keeping our interest going in the program, although you lost interest, but we were going on. Thank you, Rahim. Thanks to Isma Dili for collecting funds from the first-year medical students at UBC. Where is Isma? Isma, thank you very much. And two young women, Laura Williams and Lindsay Evans, student of the Hensworth Secondary School, for collecting funds from the students at the school. I hope they are here. Thank you. Thank you very much. We like to thank the sponsors. You have this list here. You have seen this list. Each one of them contributed more than $200 just for keeping the names there. Just that, $200. Isn't that an excellent thing? And they have helped us to reach a total, now this is a secret, a total of more than $20,000. And I think now let me tell you a secret. The money is with Al-Noor Samji, the charter accountant. Al-Noor, you are in charge, right? Okay. The BC Muslim Association, of which I am a member, held a very successful fundraising dinner on May 1st. And at the same time, many Muslim mosques and centers are actively engaged in raising funds for the peoples of Kosovo. To them, we say our heartfelt thanks for your efforts. Our thanks are also due to the following faith and community groups and organizations for their presence this evening. First and foremost, President Nazir Murji of the Ismailia Muslim Council of BC, Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Vancouver, and my great friend Archbishop Adam Exner. I am thankful for the presence of the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Vancouver here. The Canadian Jewish Congress, and my friend Michael Alterman, who happens to be also the vice president of my Committee for Racial Justice, and he is the national secretary of the Canadian Jewish Congress in Canada. I'd like to thank my friend Satnam Johal and the president of the Westminster Gurudwara and members of the Sikh community and Sare and new Westminster. What they did was, this is one thing, especially the Gurudwara Sahib Dashmesh Darbar of Sare, they collected 4 truckloads of blanket and shoes and have already shipped them to Kosovo to help the refugees. The Arab Muslim community of Nova Mainland, they have done an excellent job. And actually, Joy Ayache just came before these things and presented me with gift certificates of $500 to say, anytime you decide to hold a another fundraising dinner, I would be prepared to give these gift vouchers if you are holding a raffle. We will do that for sure, Joy Ayache, and thank you very much for your very generous offer. To all of them, we say thank you. We would like to thank Constable Philip Reed and Constable Ajit Tiwana of RCMP for their support and their presence this evening. Thank you very much indeed. To thank Said Nagash and Munira Nagash for videotaping this event. Thank you, Said and Munira. Thank you very much. I would like to take this opportunity to recognize Mr. Mumtaz Ali, who has been the past president of CMCC and also the president of the BC Muslim Association. Our thanks are to the Doctors Without Borders, who have come to our help and have given us a great help in trying to provide for tax exemption receipts. And thank you very much. You can be sure that the money will be sure, I'm sure, will be very well spent for those who need that. Thank you. Our sincere thanks go to the Radisson Hotel and President Shiraz Haji for their excellent support and very generous donation. The outside punch and number of other facilities were donated by the hotel, and the dinner you had was provided to us at a very reasonable price, and that's tonight. As I have already said, we would like to thank very much all sponsors whose names appear in our program and their generosity and their valuable support. Now, you did notice that we are very loyal and very nationalist-minded Canadians. We find it difficult sometimes if you ask us what is the Canadian identity, and we will say it's not American, but it is Canadian. That's how much we know, you see. But we are different. And that's why we start with All Canada, and I am very thankful to Farzana Jaffer Jeraj, who had an excellent reading in our bilingual, in 2 languages, English and French. Where is Farzana? Thank you. As you have already heard, we had dual purpose in organizing this event. The first objective was, of course, to raise funds. But equally important was our efforts to create awareness of the sad situation and the plight and suffering of the Kosovar people. Ladies and gentlemen, without your generosity, without your presence, your understanding, and your excellent support, this would have not been possible. To you all, we say, may God bless you and reward you for your efforts. I bid you peace and good wishes. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to the close of tonight's program. But let us bear in mind that the close of tonight's program does not represent a close to the issue that we have discussed today. And please bear in mind that these issues are happening every day and everywhere, and it is our responsibility to help prevent these type of activities. I thank you once again for coming to tonight's dinner, and I hope that you all take this opportunity to meet with each other, to get to know new people, and to take advantage of the hall, which, as Dee said, we had until 11 o'clock this evening. Thank you very much, and have a safe journey home.